Hey everybody, my name is Chris and this is my shop partner Oots, and in this video we're going to talk about everything you need to know about going to a proper hardwood lumber yard. When I first went to a proper hardwood dealer, I was pretty intimidated and overwhelmed. They're very unique places and not at all like the normal lumber yards at your big box store. My hope with this video is to educate you a little bit and provide some nice info and tips to make your first or even your next trip to that hardwood dealer a little bit easier. Now, before you actually head to a hardwood lumber yard, it's a good idea to bring a few items. The first is a list of the lumber that you're going to need. You'll want to know the size board you'll need for your project, as well as the approximate board footage, and we'll talk about board feet a little bit later. Then you want to have a notepad, a calculator, a pencil, a pair of gloves to handle rough splintery lumber if you don't have good calluses on your hands, a tape measure, and a block plane that you can use to take a few passes on those rough boards to get an idea of what the grain looks like underneath. So now let's head over to my local hardwood dealer, which is Johnson's Workbench in Charlotte, Michigan. And they're also the sponsor of this video, so thank you, Johnson's. Let's get going and I'm gonna show you all sorts of really good info. So one of the first things you'll notice when walking into a hardwood dealer is that all the boards are usually stacked in similar size lengths and thicknesses, but they're all different widths, unlike at a typical construction lumber yard where all the boards are gonna be exactly the same size in each stack. This is because with hardwood, the sawyer is trying to maximize yield out of each log, and because these hardwood logs usually aren't being milled for construction uses, they don't need to be the same size. It's left up to the woodworker or furniture maker to dimension that wood down to their needs. And so most of the lumber, and at the lowest cost at a hardwood dealer, is going to be rough sawn. That just means the lumber hasn't had any machining done to it besides what happened when it was sawed at the sawmill. But don't worry if you don't have a joiner or a planer at home to finish dimensioning that rough lumber. Hardwood dealers usually have lumber that's already dimensioned to different levels. You have S4S, which stands for surfaced four sides. It means that both faces are milled to an even thickness and both edges are ripped straight. Then S3S means that both faces are milled and one edge is ripped straight. This allows you to place that ripped edge against your table saw at home and rip the other edge to whatever width you want. Then S2S boards have both faces surfaced, but the edges are left rough. Now these boards with extra milling done to them are usually going to be a little more expensive because of the machines needed and the labor that went into processing the boards. One of my favorite things about Johnson's is that I can have them mill my rough lumber right on site and to my specs, and it's super cheap. I usually pick out whatever rough lumber I need and I'll have them mill it to S3S. Some places call it S2S, R1E, and that just means surface two faces, rip one edge. Then I can rip the other face at home. It saves me a ton of time in the shop, and it's definitely money well spent. And I want to stop real quick and thank Johnson's Workbench for sponsoring this video. I've been coming here and working with them for years, and I really feel blessed to have such an incredible lumber and woodworking supply so close to home. I also want to let you know that I'll once again be presenting this year at their annual Wood Expo, so put September 6th and 7th on your calendar and come out to Johnson's Workbench in Charlotte, Michigan for some really good deals on lumber, tools galore, tons of great booths and demonstrations and presentations. And Johnson's also has a location down in South Bend, Indiana, so if you're ever in the Michigan or Indiana area, it's definitely worth a trip to go check them out. But if you can't make it, they also ship all over the country, so give their website a visit. I'll put a link to that down in the description. Now let's talk about the different cuts of lumber. Boards will come in either what's called flat or plain sawn, rift sawn, or quarter sawn. Flat or plain sawn boards have growth rings primarily going across the width of the boards. This causes that cathedral pattern on the face. And this is probably the most common type of board you'll find at a hardwood dealer because of the way they typically mill logs at the sawmill. The next type of board is rift sawn, and those boards typically have growth rings between 30 and 60 degrees to the face. These are ideal for table legs, makes them nice and stable, and it shows nice straight grain lines on each face. Finally, there's quarter sawn, and that's lumber that has growth rings running between 60 and 90 degrees to the face. This is very stable wood, meaning it doesn't want to cup, shrink, expand, twist, or warp as much as plain sawn might. And on certain species, it has a very desirable characteristic that shows up. In some species like oak and sycamore, the quarter sawn lumber gets separated and charged at a premium, but in other species where it's not as visually desirable, it might not be. Now let's talk about how hardwood lumbers are graded. Hardwoods are graded by standards that are set forth by the National Hardwood Lumber Association, the highest of those standards being FAS, which stands for first and seconds. Those boards have to be a minimum of 6 inches wide, 8 feet long, and have to have over 83% clear lumber in the board. Then there's FAS one side, which as you can guess means that one side of the board has that 83% clear lumber. Then there is Selects, which is basically a FAS board, but the board can be slightly smaller with a minimum requirement of 4 inches wide and 6 inches long. These boards also have to have a certain continuous amount of clear lumber in them. It can't just be broken up into small little slices. You'll often see hardwood dealers lump those three highest quality grades together and call those selects and better. Next are number one commons, also known as cabinet grade. These have yet a smaller size requirement of 3 inches wide and 4 feet long, and then they only have to have 66% clear lumber. Then there are number twos and threes after that. I'm also gonna put all of this information on grading as well as everything else we talk about in this video in a really nice detailed printout that you can download on my website. I'll have a link to that down in the description. Now, rough sawn boards are typically sorted by length and thickness. The length is pretty straightforward. Usually they're stacked within 1 or 2 feet of each other. This stack is 9 and 10 footers. This stack is 11 and 12 footers. But within a stack, they will typically all be the same exact thickness. In lumberyard lingo, they use the term quarter, which stands for quarter of an inch, to talk about how thick a board is instead of just using inches. So typically the thinnest rough sawn board you'll see is 4/4, which means 4/4 of an inch, and 4/4 of an inch equals 1 inch. I know it may seem odd, but it makes sense to the sawyers and it's an important process when sawing lumber. Then you'll find 5/4, which is 1 1/4 inches, then 6/4, which is 1.5 inches, then 8/4, which is 2 inches, and so on and so forth. Usually the thicker boards are also gonna cost more per board foot. So what is a board foot? Hardwood lumber is priced by the board foot, which is really a measurement of the volume of the wood. It's how you and the lumber yards can easily calculate the cost of all the different sized lumber you buy. A board foot has a volume that's equal to a board that is 1 inch thick, 12 inches wide, and 12 inches long. So in front of me, I have different examples of boards that are one board foot, but they're different sizes. Here's kind of your standard example of a board that's one board foot. It's 1 inch thick, 12 inches long, and 12 inches wide. But you can have boards that are different sizes that also equal one board foot. Here's another board. It's 6 inches wide, but 2 inches thick. Being 12 inches long, I still get to that one board foot volume. Here's another board. It's actually 2 feet long, still 1 inch thick, and 6 inches wide. Again, this is one board foot. Now, when you get into other boards that aren't one board feet, you can get to that calculation by finding out how many board feet are in that board. Here's an example of a board that if I lay this one board foot board on it, I can see I got 1, 2, and a little bit, maybe 1/4. So this is probably 2.25 board feet. And you calculate that by multiplying the thickness of the board, the width of the board, and the length of the board. Now let's imagine all three of these boards are the same species of white oak. Now this board here, being 2 inches thick or 8/4, would be more expensive than this board, which is just 4/4 or 1 inch thick. Now let's say this middle board is quarter sawn. Again, even though this is one board foot and this is one board foot, this one in the middle would actually cost more because it's a more desirable type of wood. It's that quarter sawn board. So to recap, the species of the wood, its grade such as FAS, the growth ring orientation such as flat sawn or quarter sawn, and its thickness are all going to be factors that affect the price of the board foot. Now that your head is spinning from regular lumber, let's talk about the different plywoods you can expect to find at a place like Johnson's. First of all, you're gonna find a much higher quality plywood and a larger variety at an actual hardwood dealer than you would at your big box store or a normal lumber yard. Again, those guys are catering to construction and home builders rather than woodworking and furniture. Now there are tons of different types of plywoods. You can get them in sheets from 1/8 inch thick all the way up to 1 inch, maybe even thicker. You can also get them in different numbers of plies. 1/2 inch sheet might have 5 plies, but another might have 7. You can get them in different grades and qualities and with all sorts of different types of veneers and face patterns. So for the purpose of woodworking, the two main grades of plywood to talk about are cabinet grade and marine grade. And as you would guess, cabinet grade is perfect for cabinet and furniture making. With cabinet grade plywood, this is where you find a big variety of different veneer surfaces and numbers of plies, from the widely used Baltic birch plywood to cherry, oak, maple, walnut, and many more. Unlike construction plywood you typically find at box stores, the quality of these sheets are gonna be awesome. The next grade of plywood is marine grade. Now these are manufactured to the highest quality and only certain woods and glues are used to make them great for boat building and marine applications. They're very durable and handle wet and humid conditions better than any other type of plywood. Some common marine plywoods are Hydrotech, which is usually made from a wood called Moranti, Okume, which is also another very common marine plywood, which is super durable and not quite as heavy as Hydrotech. I'm actually gonna be building a plywood boat for fly fishing out of Okume, so make sure you subscribe and catch that whole series. You can also get teak, sapele, and a couple other marine grade plywoods. With plywood, the grading is different than hardwood lumber. They use a letter and number system. The face veneer is usually graded A through E, with A being the best and E being the worst. The back is graded 1 through 4, with 1 being the best, 4 being the worst. Back veneers that are 1 or 2 will usually be the same species as the front, and 3 and 4 could be a different species. So an A1 graded plywood is going to be the nicest sheet of cabinet grade plywood you can get. Now with marine plywood, the grading is a little bit different, and the highest quality grade possible is BS 1088 or BS 6566. The BS stands for British Standards. It's the highest quality level of plies possible, and that means there's no more than a 0.3 millimeter void allowed within any of those plies. In other plywoods, larger internal voids are allowed. If you've ever cut through a sheet of construction plywood, you'll know and you've seen some of those huge voids. Now you can also choose plywoods with different veneer patterns to give you all sorts of different aesthetic choices. They do this by slicing the veneers off the log in many different ways. There's rotary cut, plane slicing, rift cut, and quarter slicing. Then those veneers can also be glued down in a variety of different patterns as well to give different desired looks there. You can get them in whole pieces, book matched, random, slip matched, or pleasing. So here's a couple of different examples of how they can put the veneer on the sheet of plywood. Here you have a rotary cut whole piece, and on this board, you have a rift cut that's book matched. So let's take a quick look at one of the labels you might find at a hardwood dealer. Right up here, this group of numbers tells you that it's plywood, it's hard maple, half inch thick. WPF stands for whole piece face. That means that it's not a book match or anything like that. It's one whole piece of veneer. C2 tells you the grade. So the face is a C, the back is a number 2, and then UV one side. Down here, it goes into a little more detail. Again, it's half inch, it's a 4x8 hard maple sheet of plywood. It also tells you that it's rotary cut, not rift cut or quarter sawn cut. Here again, it's WPF, whole piece face, C2, the grade. VC tells you it's veneer core. That's your most common type of plywood. That means that all the pieces within are all gonna be veneer. The other type you might run into is CFC, which stands for combined fiber core. That means that the layer just underneath the outside veneer is gonna be a fiber board. That just helps the piece of plywood be a little bit more stable. Then again, it's UV one side. The UV kind of just gives protection against the sun. Now that you know all sorts of good info to get you off on the right foot when going to the lumberyard, let me just talk briefly about lumberyard etiquette. Now there's two main things. First, don't be scared to ask for help. They're not only happy to answer questions, but also happy to help you sort and pick your lumber and also give you advice on the best species and types of woods for certain applications. Also, try not to be the person who wants the board at the very bottom of the stack. The grading of the boards is going to be the same at the top as it is on the bottom. And it's also important to mention that you should plan on buying about 20 to 25% more than you need, because there's gonna be waste. And that's just the nature of the beast when working with hardwoods. And always pick up after yourself. Don't leave a big mess of lumber for the workers or the next guy. Well, everyone, I hope you learned a few things. I hope this video helped shine some light on hardwoods and plywoods and helps get you ready for your next trip to a hardwood dealer. And if you have any other tips, please let me know down in the comment section so other people can read and learn from those as well. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video. Thanks, guys.